I think that the big question here about designing with BIM is a problematic one, and one that I think a lot of people are still struggling with in the industry. Oftentimes I feel like building information modeling is put in this box of being only for production or only for delivery, and people get really hesitant about using BIM for design, or you know, using it to help describe some of these complex, more, I guess, more fashionable types of architecture. And I really wanted to turn this notion on its head for this particular assignment. I wanted students to be able to engage purely with building information modeling and parametric tools strictly for the purposes of design, out of which came all the the cool things that BIM offers us with in terms of tracking information in a database, and efficiently organizing your drawings, and coordinating different types of information. So instead of the typical Revit curriculum that you might see, where you're opening up Revit and you're kind of modeling out some grids, placing walls and doors, this assignment really came about by understanding Revit from the ground up. And as a design problem, in many ways started with the family environment. In most cases, I think one of two environments, right? So the adaptive component environment and the tools available there, and pattern-based curtain systems. So they actually started out this design problem by first exploring what kinds of assemblies and modules they could begin to make, and what what that could actually lead to in an overall context. So part of the design problem was designing their module and understanding all the relationships inherent within that module. The second part of assignment became about deploying that module. Right. So after they had designed it, they needed to create, in some ways, a rig, using like the conceptual massing environment, or even just inside the project environment. They had to design a rig that could begin to host those modules too, and then they could begin to produce design variations with. So in this case, you're seeing an example of an adaptive component that this particular student designed, which actually is one of the more complex ones. There's kind of these like faceted ribbon pieces, and these are some of the schedules that they're deriving from this, and they're taking this and hosting it to what you can envision as a couple of host lines or a host surface that then begins to replicate this for a given effect. And so they're going back and forth a lot. In this stage of the project, they're starting out, kind of modeling their component, testing it out in the project environment or the family environment, and then going back, reworking the module, maybe testing it out on different rigs and so on. Here's another example of the development of one of these modules to kind of the scale of kind of a more full blown project. So their overall project in this case was a very open ended problem of, we just want to create an abstract pedestrian bridge that connects kind of two points in space over a kind of a ravine or canyon or river. And so the problem then became, okay, what kinds of expressive systems can we design that connect those two points in space, and what kind of systems can we then begin to layer onto it that will help us achieve the desired effects? They're going back and forth between, I think, rendering, 3D visualization, and these spreadsheets, which is really interesting to me. So the idea of the spreadsheet or the the Revit schedule becomes yet another thing that they had to kind of deal with and wrestle with, right? The earlier assignments were purely about visual representation using kind of the more normative modes of visualizing a design, such as plan, section, elevation, 3D view, axonometric, where the notion of BIM comes in here is, since everything's kind of just a view of a database, what kinds of database views can we actually produce and begin to get kind of a different type of understanding of the project than at the other views, the more conventional views may not let us have into the project. So each of the components that they had to make had to be schedulable. So these schedules are tracking things like variation in dimension from component to component, if they had another parameter that's controlling aperture size or some variable, these schedules are capturing that. And then the schedule became a way for them to understand at a numerical level, at a spreadsheet level, all the types of variations that are kind of inherent or packed away into their design. So again, as I mentioned, they're dealing with drawing, they're dealing with, you know, an understanding of their project using the, you know, the conventional orthographic views. One of the key challenges that was put forth to them, whereas in the last projects, you know, they're able to use Illustrator and they were using Illustrator and all of these things to get their drawings to kind of become post-produced and look really, really good. They were kind of given the challenge of within Revit, what kinds of things can you do to improve and get kind of the visual effect of the design that you're hoping to get. How do you make your drawing look like the drawing that you want it to be rather than what the program just kind of spits out at you afterwards? So this is an example, I think, of a pretty successful drawing that was done by a student, obviously, you know, taken from the model, but then through the manipulation of the visual visibility graphics and overrides, they're, you know, fine-tuning the look of the drawing to get it to communicate the things that they want to communicate. And then on the complete, you know, opposite end of the spectrum, they're then having to also consider all the information that is underlaying that drawing, right? So they're kind of having to work between this world, things that architects, I think, are very, very comfortable with, and also to kind of engage this world and put together kind of a sensible data set around their design. Their final deliverables were really focused on, you know, composing a drawing set, so utilizing Revit for what, you know, it is really, really good at, which is, you know, organizing your model, tracking your model, establishing views into the model, and organizing things into a drawing set. So they were tasked with, you know, putting together all of the, after composing the model, putting together everything within a single drawing set. And then their deliverable to me from there was then, you know, a design review model, which included both a 3D snapshot of their model, which, you know, the end user could begin to navigate around, of course, and pick on different objects and get information about them. So all of the parameters for every object was, you know, captured here. And also this single document also captured their entire drawing set. So for me, this is like the last thing I saw from them. They're delivering kind of a comprehensive look into their model, into their design after they've composed it, using a method of delivery, which I think is far more common now, the idea of being able to exchange information digitally rather than, you know, plotting out these massive stacks of paper. They were encouraged to really engage the digital. I think one of the big points that I wanted to instill in the class, kind of moving forward throughout the class, is that we emphasize the fact that the tools that they may be using in this particular class at the start of their academic careers as designers may or may not be the same tools that they're going to be using in their professional life. And so it became critical for them not to just understand how to use one particular software over another. It became critical for them to understand the basic concepts for how they can begin to think with these digital environments. So as new tools come into their toolbox, they're able to work through similar problems and get the desired outcomes that they want without having to, oh crap, I need to learn something new again. We really wanted to emphasize being nimble with the tools, being agile, and being able to work within various constraints and new constraints at any given point in time. So I'm going to thumb through just a collection of some projects. You know, these are more rendered views of some of their final works. All of these, again, are rendered 100% in Revit, and the models are all generated 100% using the conceptual modeling tools that I just described. So this is an example of one of the bridges. You know, they did some pretty interesting things, I think, with, you know, developing this relationship between structural members and kind of these skinning, interwoven skinning elements. You can kind of see there's a high level of control here which I found, you know, pretty interesting. It's kind of very, very logical in terms of how this thing progresses across this sort of watery ravine, right? And so the idea that they were, you know, managing and composing these different elements in such a way that they're getting a very controlled outcome was definitely a desirable trait for a successful project. This one was very, very interesting to me. In many ways, I would gauge the level of success of a project by if at first glance I didn't quite know how it was being composed. It would demonstrate to me that they are, you know, really investigating and trying out different things with the tool, and perhaps things that are completely unexpected or not intended with the tool. So this is actually, if you look, I think you saw a screenshot of it earlier, one of these arches is a continuous adaptive component that's made up of all of these individual polygonal elements. They're obviously studying different material objects, and they're getting an effect here as an outcome that, you know, looks in some ways very natural, but when you kind of really dig in, you can begin to see the underlying logic. I would not have expected this to come out of Revit or Vasari, but it did, which is really cool to me. This is another project that had a similar vibe to it. There's kind of this chainmail-like roof system. They're using curtain wall elements to describe this skin on the top of the project. It's kind of creating like this very scaly effect, and then you can kind of see this kind of structural frame element that weaves through this middle canyon. And so the contrast here is very interesting to me. The way that they are composing their individual design elements that they're designing into an overall composition, which is provocative again. And again, a use of different materials and things like that. This one's pretty cool. You can kind of very clearly see that they're using a lot of the conceptual massing features here to also describe things like kind of a very smooth form. So, and they're also interweaving that with uses of tools like the adaptive component and, you know, pattern-based curtain systems to contrast that. You can see a very kind of clear intentionality between how they are navigating elements in their model that are kind of more solid versus elements that are more kind of transparent and perforated. And that's kind of really what I'm looking for, right? I'm looking for their ability to assess their project and make critical decisions about the elements that they pick, about the different capabilities that they're picking inside of their design software, to the effect that they're achieving the desired design outcome. This is, again, another one of those projects that when I opened up the model, when I opened up kind of this particular image, I was like, whoa, how did they do that? And I really think that's a successful criteria with which to evaluate digital design projects as they're being produced, especially by students that are you know, just starting out with it. I look for things that are unexpected. I look for things that have a great deal of complexity to them, where you can just see by looking at it, wow, the student really engaged the problem, and that they really wanted to explore different ideas given the constraints of their environment. And to kind of finish this up, this is, you know, one of the last projects which I was very, very impressed with, just because the uses of what's an adaptive component, what's a conceptual mass is not completely obvious. These are actually adaptive components, and they're composed in such a way where, you know, it has sort of a wispiness to it, you know, and it doesn't quite have the geometry that I would associate with adaptive components, at least ones that I've built in the past, but they've kind of taken a creative, you know, put a creative spin on it to construct these very smooth elements and this overall composition, which if I were to look at this, I'd be like, oh yeah, someone used Rhino or Maya to define parts of this, but that wasn't so. When you actually get into the model, they actually did take the time to figure out how to get these kinds of effects going with the tools at their disposal. So you can check out more of these projects on my blog. You can find information about the students themselves there as well. If you want to know, see the actual credits associated with some of the projects, you can find all that information there. And again, you can find all the curricular materials that were used during the course of this class there as well. So I think we can open it up to questions and discussion at this point. What I would like to do is actually start engaging Dan and Matt and perhaps some of their observations on how the students were, learning their software day-to-day and the different approaches that they took, or, just general observations on how they, approached the actual instructional, tutorials on some of these tools.
Dan and Matt, do you have anything that you want to add right now?
One of the main things I want to say was it was very impressive to see how the students came into play. Whether they did have advanced knowledge with computers before, they even challenged them farther trying to use that system as a way to define their project rather than just, I'm going to make a cylinder and then I'm going to morph it in this respect. It's trying to think how they went together. That was one of my favorite parts of seeing them develop.
Yeah, it's really, really impressive. I mean, these were mostly first and second year students, undergrad, is that right?
Yeah, this is their first time.
I mean, to see what they came up with really blows me away. One of the questions that I had for you was, were a lot of these projects kind of preconceived? I mean, maybe this is what you were getting into a little bit, but were these preconceived notions of what they wanted to build and then they found a way to come up with that? Or was it kind of a combination of exploring what the technology could offer them and coming up with a design through their kind of technological explorations, if you will?
I would answer that question as I think there's a bit of both. Some students would come to class with sketches of their ideas on pencil and paper and which they wanted to do, but I think they found very, very quickly that that became hard to translate exactly what they wanted. So there's a learning process on how to understand the tool, and then that tool then reinformed how they would go about designing. So I think there was a bit of both. Some students never touched pen and paper and just let the tool and their understanding of the tool kind of inform how they would design and how they came up with their final compositions.
Yeah, I agree with that too, because it was like, depending on what you ended up showing them, and then, because like if you showed one thing, then all of a sudden the next day they all had the repeating element along the line, but then that was just to demonstrate the tool, but then some would go down that path, like Dan said, where they did the bring in the sketches, because that was how they can think, and it really developed how each student understood and problem solved.
Yeah, I think the notion of problem solving is key to courses like this, especially in the design context. One of the struggles that, and I'm sure Dan and Matt can speak to this in their own experiences as well, kind of going through the same program, is when you would take a software course, the typical approach is that you're given kind of a finite set of variables. You might be given a precedent to follow, or you might be given a very kind of rigorous set of instructional exercises where you're kind of going through step by step to build it up, which I think has a certain amount of value. Especially if you're looking at the breadth, if you want to understand kind of the breadth of a piece of software. For me, I've never really learned best by going through kind of those kinds of tutorial-esque exercises. I've always learned best through kind of my own tinkering, through my own understanding of the intentionality that I want to achieve, right? So I might say, some of the work on my blog is indicative of this, I might say, okay, I want to understand this problem, and so I'm going to fire up my software and figure out, understanding kind of the problem and the outcome I want to achieve, I'm going to figure out kind of a solution for this given kind of the tools at my disposal. And so I really wanted to frame the exercises to reflect that. So they're given open-ended problems, they're not given precedents, and then they had to feel their way through the problem with the tools at their disposal to get to that, which I think ended up with, one, some really creative solutions at the end of the day. And number two, it ended up with, I think, a better understanding on their part related to the kinds of tools that they were using than if they were to just follow kind of step-by-step exercises.
Yeah, that's definitely true, because a lot of the times, sometimes they come in, when we start getting farther down the process, they'd ask a question, like they wanted to get a desired effect. Well, then you had to figure out how you could use everything to get to that effect. And that was neat, rather than saying, I just want to make a screwdriver like some of the earlier tutorials we had done.
Yeah, I'll echo what Nate was saying as well about discovery. I think that a lot of what was meant in the course was about discovering the programs and some of the aspects, and a lot of the assignments that Nate proposed in the class allowed that to happen, allowed the students to discover the program rather than have us instruct just certain aspects of the program. I found that really fun because I believe Matt and I probably both learned quite a bit by teaching it that way. We learned problems that we wouldn't have discovered, but it was brought to us by the students themselves.
Mm-hmm. Yes, definitely.
I think you know, kind of bring it, as I know there's a number of professionals on the line probably that are interested in this subject, and I kind of wanted to bring it back to industry and kind of what I'm seeing happen with architectural firms and firms that are, you know, engaging these tools. You know, a lot of our clients, you know, they always, I think, struggle with the notion of training and educating folks on the job. And, you know, at CASE, what we found as being a very successful model is, you know, doing kind of training or, you know, workshops in the context of projects, because we find that knowledge sticks when the group that is learning the software, learning through a new software, is able to immediately relate it to the problems that they're having to solve every day, which in some ways was the impetus or inspiration for organizing this particular class that way.